Good morning. I'm your density. How many of you have seen Back to the Future? Good, because this has become the Back to the Future sermon. Today we're going to talk about listening with understanding, and this message, honestly, if you are struggling in any of your relationships, this message is going to help you. But let me tell you something even bigger. These facts, these details, these truths in Scripture that we're going to discuss today, I know people who've been Christians for 20, 30, 40 years, and they said to me, "Eric, I never knew that. I never understood that. You know, basically, why didn't somebody tell me earlier?" And here's the deal. As you watch that video clip, if you're like me, you're rooting, even if you've seen the movie 50 times, you're rooting for George McFly. Some of you, even though you've seen that clip 100 times, sit there and go, "Is he going to get it right this time?" Which, isn't that funny how we are? But you're like, "Come on, George, spit it out." You notice he didn't have any trouble talking to Marty, his son, which, yeah. Right? But all of a sudden it changed. Why? And it has to do with listening to Biff and listening to the bullies in your life. And here's the deal. Some of you, your whole life, have been bullied. Now, I'm not talking about a literal bully. Sometimes the bully that exists is in your head, because you have an enemy who wants to think you to think that God hates your guts and doesn't want a relationship with you and all kind of things. Others of you were told by parents or other people that you valued that you didn't matter. And today's message, I'm hoping, will dispel some of that and maybe start a new way of thinking for you that then will impact how you treat other people. You'll be able to give other people grace, that you can look at somebody and when they say, "I don't believe what you believe," you can say, "Okay." And it doesn't even faze you. When I was in seventh grade, there was a new girl at our school named Amy. And I thought Amy was adorable. By the way, just to preface this, those of you who know me know that two words that don't go together are Eric Brookins, smooth. Eric Brookins, well, there's a lot of words that don't go with that, but Eric Brookins, calm would be, but Eric Brookins and smooth have never gone together. I've never dated anyone or had a good friend of mine say, "You know, Eric, you're just smooth." No, doesn't happen. And this story was not just the beginning, but it was one of the first girls that I really kind of had to step out on a limb to show her that I cared about her. So Amy came to our school. I thought she was cute. We had our first roller skating field trip. So back then, I don't know, I guess schools could go roller skating. Now you're not allowed to do anything. But anyway, so we went roller skating. I'm sure there was disco played. I'm sure Casey and the Sunshine Band was on the record list. So while we were there, it was time for couple skate. And I went and found Amy and said, "Would you skate with me?" She said, "Yeah, I'll skate with you." And I still remember, we skated round and round. The DJ put on AC/DC. "You Shook Me All Night Long." Great Christian song. And, right. So, if you only knew all the things that I just did not say, you would say, "Smooth, Brookins, smooth." The filter actually came on. So we did that, and then February came, and I thought, you know, I'm going to ask her to be my girlfriend. I'm going to ask her to be my Valentine. So I got my sister, who was driving at that time, to take me to the store. I bought a nice box of the heart-shaped chocolate, the good stuff, not the cheap junk, good stuff. Got the good, real good chocolate, and had it all ready, you know, all the different flavors where, you know, it's labeled so you don't have to guess, you know, what is that I just ate, right? So, but in Miami, you couldn't put stuff in your locker that could melt, so I actually had to carry the box to class, to which people were kind of wondering. While I'm sitting in first period, my plan was, I knew I saw her between periods, between first and second. I kind of looked forward to that every day. I was going to pass her, so I kind of knew that was going to happen. I knew where her class was and my class was, and knew we were going to pass each other. But as I sat with that box of chocolates, either on my desk or next to my desk, I heard somebody next to me say, "Hey, did you hear? Tim, one of the coolest kids in the school, played football and asked Amy to be his girlfriend, and she said yes." So now I didn't know what to do because Brookings is smooth, so I still had the box of chocolates. Between class, I saw Amy, and this was my Napoleon Dynamite moment. If you haven't seen that movie, I just made a reference that you have no clue. But I basically, this is what I did. I went up to her and I said, "Here," and walked off. Just walked off. Nothing. A little bit later in the day, in about fourth period, I look over, Tim's in class with me. Got the top off and he's eating a box of chocolates. I get home and my sister says, I tell her what happened and she says, "I thought you knew that girl liked you. What'd you do, buy her a box of chocolate for?" Now you've all been there where you feel rejection. It's actually painful for me. As funny as that story is, it's kind of still painful to tell that story. And here's the deal for you and for me. We all have a story like that. We all have a story where somebody shamed us or somebody rejected us or we did something really dumb and we just felt the weight of rejection come over us or something happened that was so horrible that we just, that memory is burned there. And here's the truth. Because of that, that has always existed since sin began. This idea of shame and guilt, and I'm going to talk about the difference between those, and this idea of shame, though, of the enemy constantly telling us that you're not worthy of love or acceptance and you need to be rejected, causes us to do all kinds of things. And so I'm going to talk about why we struggle to hear God in others. I'm going to talk about that struggle, and then I'm going to give you some practical applications, basically what God thinks about you and then how to talk to others. And whether they agree with you or not, whether they have the same value system you do or not, you can love people if you learn these truths. So let's start with the most basic things. These three truths I'm going to talk about, or four truths, are the reason that people in churches wear masks. They're the reason that you and I want to try to conform to the people around us. It's the reason that sometimes we just act like everything's okay because we don't want anybody thinking, "Hey, brother." Right now, I can tell you, there's churches. I've been on staff at a lot of them, and this person goes there. But I know this person during the week, and they don't look like this. This is before medication. After, right? And so here's a few truths, and this is what sin did to us, and it's why we struggle. Number one, we are afraid of being rejected. No one likes rejection. Nobody wakes up in the morning and goes, "Gosh, I really hope that I am not accepted today. I just hope somebody's mean to me." And we... Listen, there's a thousand ways we're rejected. I had a friend who's driving, I don't know if this was his post or he posted it from someone else, but it said, "I was driving today and I accidentally cut somebody off, and instead of giving me the finger, they gave me a thumbs down, and somehow that hurt my feelings more." Right? That's us though, isn't it? Have you ever been in a line? I accidentally took 30 items in the 10 item lane not too long ago, didn't know it, and I wanted to crawl under a rock. I wanted to buy the groceries for the people behind me. One lady was so mad, I thought she was going to cuss me out right there. I apologized 40 times. I tried to take the stuff off. The person behind me said, no, don't you do that. Don't take me. No. Right? And we've all done those things where we're like, "Oh, please reject me." It started early. God said, "I got one rule for you." And Adam and Eve said, "Yeah, it sounds good. Let's hang out by the tree. Let's not hang out anywhere else in the garden. Let's hang out right where that could happen." And you know the whole serpent story and the whole deal. It's totally a study of human nature. That's why the Bible is so awesome. You read things that thousands of years ago were written and you're like, that's still true. So God says, where are you? By the way, God never asks you a question he doesn't know the answer to. He didn't create the universe and not be able to see them behind a bush. Like, I created Saturn, but oops, where'd you go? Right? I created every molecule, but the bush, ooh, bush, right? So he thought he was hiding, and it says this, I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid. People still struggle with this today. When you walk in the lobby, if you're new to our church, you struggle with that on your way in, or you struggle with that as you come into this room. You will struggle with that as you walk into a restaurant if somehow you feel like every eye is upon you, or you walk into a meeting room. I went to a meeting not too long ago where I was supposed to be sat at a table, and they did not have a place setting for me. It was everything inside of me to not walk out of that meeting and just go home. And I know better, but I went and sat by myself. And I, as an old man with a doctorate degree, thought, well, if they don't want me, I don't know what I'm here for. It's the reason why if you walk into Publix on Garden Street or on Highway 50 in Titusville or the one here in Port St. John, somebody who works there, if they're near the front at all, if they see you walk in, they will say, hey, welcome to Publix. And you'll think, shopping is such a... See, you said that. I didn't even have to, right? Because there's something in us. And that's the reason we have a greeting time at church. It's not because we're not trying to get you to know everybody. We just don't want you to be sitting there going, is this person weird next to me? Or do they like me, right? Why? Because I knew that. And you knew that. It's all right. Number two, we're ashamed of who we are or what we've done. And there's a difference between who you are and what you've done, and we're going to kind of talk about that in just a minute. I wish I had more time. This sermon then could take a year on. And then he says, and by the way, I tried to change. I looked at this next little section, I looked at least 10 different versions of the Bible. I tried to find one that said unclothed. I almost changed the Bible so that I didn't have to say this word because I cannot pronounce this word and I want to be accepted and loved. And people make fun of me when I say, I was naked. Because I say it like a hillbilly. You say potato, I say tater. Right? And so that's even one word that I'm like, I got to change. And so even as I was doing this study, I was ashamed. I found myself going, I don't want to say that. You know, Dr. Eric Brookins can't say naked. I looked at every version, couldn't find it. Here's the deal. Someone in your life told you you were useless. Maybe you had a coach told you that. Maybe it was a teacher. Maybe it was a parent. Maybe it wasn't what your parents said, it was the way they acted. Maybe they were too busy for you, so you felt left out, rejected. You remember that. Maybe you were hurt. Maybe something someone did to you, you felt like you deserved it. The enemy will tell you all that stuff to try to destroy you. And if you're not careful, you'll say, I'm going to hide, or I'm ashamed of who I am. And you'll be like George McFly. You'll get around people and you won't even be able to talk. Or if you do, you're putting on a mask because you don't want them to see who you really are. Number three, third thing we do is we try to hide our shame from others. Adam says, so I hid. We do that all the time. We hide behind all kinds of things. We hide behind entertainment. We hide behind humor. We hide behind sarcasm. Nah. Yeah. We hide behind all kinds of things. Why? Because we want to hide our shame. Brené Brown says that shame is an intensely personal feeling that we're unworthy of love and belonging. It's not just the idea that we don't think, but we don't even think we belong. Why? So that's why we try to fit in. That's why you go to a lot of churches today and the people actually dress the same. They pick up a language. There's times where people talk around me, and I run in Christian circles a lot. I am a pastor. So I go to these Christian meetings and I hear people, and a lot of times I can tell you what church they went to because of some word they use that no other church uses, but it's become an accepted word in their culture and they think everybody should know it. So they say these odd things and you're like, that's really odd, until you get around all of them. Then you're like, oh, all these people use that word and it feels accepted. It feels, we like conformity. Why? Because it's a way to hide. But then number four, we blame or criticize others to feel better about ourselves. This is the root of gossip. We think if I look at somebody else and can say what they did wrong, then I look better. Because I don't feel good about me, I've got to make them look bad so that I feel like I've risen up. And all of us know somebody who always, always is negative. Somebody who always is putting other people down, always critiquing and criticizing. They're the people, they're the Simon Cowells of the world, right? They come in with their list to tell you what you did wrong. Why? Because they're trying to put the blame on someone else. You think that's new? Listen to this verse. God basically, you know, addresses it, and Adam says this: the woman that you put here with me, she gave me fruit, and I ate it. Now listen, what in the world was Adam thinking God was going to do? Adam basically says, God, this woman, you know, out of the rib that you gave me, yeah, your fault. You and her go have a talk, and when you're ready to apologize, come back. And God, you know what? I got plenty of ribs. And, you know, I could be Mormon. There's like a bunch. You could just give me a bunch of wives, right? You know, I don't know what he was thinking. But he blames her and God. I sometimes wonder, what if Adam had just said, I blew it. I messed up. When you were a kid, didn't your parents say, because you lied, your punishment's worse than you? You lied anyway. All of us know somebody who's negative. How many of you know somebody, and you even thought of them when I said, do you know somebody negative or who gossips all the time? Anybody in here know that person? Raise your hand, come on. I see those hands, yes, I see. I feel your pain. What's funny is, can I tell you something? That person doesn't know it's them. To Adam, this was a normal sentence. God, this woman you gave me. I mean, you created the universe, and you messed up here, so could you fix it? We think that what we say is normal. We think gossip is normal. We think putting other people down is normal. We think trying to build ourselves up by shoving somebody else down is normal. Why? Because we don't even realize that we do it because we're trying to feel accepted. We're trying to get the shame off of us. By the way, when you were a kid, somebody might have said, shame on you. Well, let me tell you what God says, shame off you. So let's talk about some basics. The first part's going to go slow and the second part's going to go fast. So I'll let you know that. How to listen to God and then how to listen with others with understanding. Number one, we're going to talk about understanding what God thinks about you. If you don't learn anything else today, we're going to talk about this. This would change your life, this one thing alone, if you'll get this idea. Number one, you can believe what God's word, what the Bible, what he says in his word about you. In Psalms 119, David said, by your words, I can see where I'm going. They throw a beam of light on my dark path. And most of you have those things. Even right now, as you're sitting here, some of you are having conversations with yourself that are not good. Your path is dark. And you need to reprogram with God's word. In John 17, Jesus was praying for us, and he said, sanctify, which means to set apart. Set them apart by your truth. Excuse me, by the truth, your word is truth. He basically said, God, would you help them to not be like everybody else? Help them to know they don't have to conform. They don't have to be exactly like everybody. But the only way you can do that is through your word. Why? Because when we believe what God says about us, it changes us. The pressure's off. What if you said this? I choose to believe what God says about me in his word. Now, most of you received a sheet of paper, a full sheet of paper. Do you have it? You can take it out if you have it. On your way in, you got a bulletin, but then you got a full sheet of paper. Did some people not get them? Did we not have enough? Did we run out? Yep. Did we run out? We did run out? Well, if you didn't get one, then you should feel bad. You're rejected, and you're not like everyone else. I will post this online later, and you can print it. I'm going to post it with the video when I post it on YouTube. If you need one of these, you can Google it. This Rick Warren's the one who said it. It's called My Faith Confessions. So you can look up My Faith Confessions, Rick Warren, and you'll find it. But here it is from the Bible. Galatians 2:20. I'm crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but Christ lives within me. 1 Corinthians 6:19. The Son has set me free. Excuse me, John 8:36. Son has set me free. I am free indeed. 1 Corinthians 6:19. My body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. And what I say all the time is apparently I'm in a temple expansion program. My brother says, I have the body of a god. I said, really? He said, yeah, Buddha. He who began a good work in me will be faithful to complete it. Philippians 1:6. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Nothing can ever separate me from the love of God in Christ Jesus. In all things, God works for the good of those who love him and those who are called according to his purpose. God is faithful. He won't let me be tempted beyond what I can bear. Some of you need to put that on the fridge. We've got more. Did they not hand those out at the door? Is that what happened? Somebody forgot? Nope. The first group didn't tell the second group. You're all fired. Shame on... Oh, I'm just kidding. Just wanted to see if you caught that. Just wanted to see if you caught that. Mike, you want me to distribute them like I did last night?
Yeah.
Last night I took them and did like that, because when I used to do it youth and they'd split up, last night I did that, and they all stayed together and fell in one person's lap. Anyway, Mike's going to pass them out, but you don't have it. God is faithful. Mike, why don't you hand a few of those to somebody else so that you don't have to pass? Oh, you did. You did. Okay, you did good. You're hired again. All right. God, by the way, Mike does all our financial stuff and harasses the pastor on a consistent basis. Our utility infielder. All right. God has not given me a spirit of fear. Did you hear that? God has not given me a spirit of fear, but a power, love, and the third one's awesome, a sound mind. Some of you need to read that one. My light and momentary troubles are achieving for me an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. On rough days, that's a great verse. He is able to do immeasurably more than I ask or imagine according to his power that's at work with me, Ephesians 3:20. And then finally, God is for me. Who can be against me? Here's what I want you to know. Some of you all day long have negative thoughts, negative things processing all day. It's still your choice. You may need to take this and make copies of it. You may need to put this at work on your cubicle. You may need to take this and on your way to work, put one of these verses over your steering wheel so you remember how much God loves you. Because the truth is, it's very, very easy for us to walk in shame and to walk in fear and to walk in rejection and then to put that on other people. Now that you have your sheets, you can read it while I preach the rest of the message. Number two. This is huge. If more Christians knew this, it would change the world. God cares more about you than your actions. And I'm telling you right now, there are people that would argue with me about this. Well, you know, sin is blah, blah, blah. Let me tell you something. Even with sin, he loves us first. Listen to what it says, Romans 5:8. But God showed his great love for us in this way. Christ died for us when we got our acts together. Oh, while we were still sinners. When you were running from God, when you were yelling from God, when you were telling God, I want nothing to do with you. He still died for you, the Bible says. He still died for you. We try to fit in. God cares more about you than your actions. God always values me. Do you realize that? God always values you. But people will try to shame you, and sometimes even when they're not trying to, we receive it that way. A few years ago, I had a pastor. I spoke at his church. He came to me later and he said, you know, Eric, you should have been a comedian instead of a pastor. He didn't say it to be nice. At another pastor, this just happened about a month ago, he said, you know, I tried to listen to one of your sermons, but it takes you so long to get to the Bible that I quit listening. You know what I wanted to say to him? You're not that great either. I've heard you preach, dude. You're, you know, who do you think, right? And he may not even meant it to be mean, but it's like, you know, people say things, and you've had those same things. Not just me as a pastor. You have those same things. People say and do all kinds of things. They give you a thumbs down in traffic. Or they tell you what your IQ is, right? God always values you. Let that sink in for a minute. God always, when you're broken and messed up and do everything wrong, and like me, you're not smooth, He still values you. Number three, God doesn't condemn you, but He changes you. Now, this is that balance. Years ago, I went to a meeting for all pastors called Promise Keepers, and they had a pastor's one. And I went to it, and I was a young youth pastor on staff at a church. And I went to there, and I'm wearing, like, T-shirt, jeans, tennis shoes, and these guys are in suits. I have this voice, which is the combination of Pee Wee Herman, Kermit the Frog, and I don't know who else, whatever this is. And these guys all,
hello, brother. How are you? Last week we had $10 billion in church and raised $4 million for whatever.
And by the way, I can tell when pastors are struggling with this because they start talking about, with other pastors, they start talking about money and numbers. Or as we used to call it years ago, nickels and noses. And it used to just be the older guys who did this, but one of the things I've noticed in some of these young churches, these young guys are starting to do that now. They talk about nickels and noses all the time. And that's when I can tell. Dude, do you realize God loves you if you had three people in your church? So I'm in this Promise Keepers meeting, and we're singing songs, and I can hear these other pastors, like, I'm singing like I do, which is, hey, you know, right? We ain't gonna laugh on the farm, right? Right? So. And I can hear them like,
God is my dude.
You know, I hear these men. I'm like, and I sat, and all of a sudden I got overwhelmingly discouraged. So discouraged that I sat down. And here's what I prayed. God, I can never be like these guys. These guys are tall. They got suits.
They have voices that sound like this.
I'm just me. I just remember, I was just so discouraged. And all of a sudden, God said, Eric, I didn't call you to be them. I called you to be you. Amen. And you just be you and let me use you. And I stood up and sang. And you know what it felt like? You know the scene at the end of Back to the Future where Marty is fading out and he's on the guitar and he barely can play. And all of a sudden, they kiss and he just goes, wow! And then he does a solo, right? That's what happened. That day, I realized I don't have to be anybody else. I can be goofy Eric Brookins who doesn't even know when to give a girl a chocolate heart for Valentine's Day. And God can use you anyway. Why? Because He values you. He loves you. He doesn't condemn you. Listen to this, John 8:11. A woman in adultery is brought out, thrown in front of Him. They're going to kill her. They all walk away. Jesus says, woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you? No one, sir, she said. Then, neither do I condemn you. Go and leave your life of sin. Now, this is the balance that Jesus always has. He loves people. He doesn't condemn them, but He also doesn't say, go and do whatever you want. Just be happy. Sin doesn't matter. You just be you. Live your own life. You know, He doesn't say that either. He realizes that sin has consequences, so He says, go, don't do that anymore. Leave your life of sin. And we're all going to struggle sometimes. And we're all going to sometimes do things which we know are wrong, and yet Jesus doesn't condemn us. But He encourages us, and He takes us, and He changes us. He loves us right where we are, and He loves us too much to leave us that way. Now, here's the deal. Because some of you struggle with this. There is a guilt, or I'll call it a conviction, that is okay. That's natural. That's actually a good thing. Only psychotic people don't have any guilt at all. Okay? You know, mass murderers, you know, they may not have any. You have some. But let me tell you the difference between guilt and conviction and shame. Guilt says, here's what you did wrong, you need to go apologize. Eric, when you were driving, hitting your brakes, when somebody tailgated you, I know you feel good, but really that's not a good thing. But God, I break for tailgaters. It's just a... So Lord, I'm sorry. I'm learning how to drive. Or maybe you got in a fight on the way to church, you know, and you feel like while the pastor's talking right now, you're like, how did he know? Because I was watching. No. So maybe you just squeeze them. Sorry. That's conviction. Shame says you're a terrible person. You'll never achieve. You'll never overcome. You're a terrible mom. You're a terrible dad. And what shame does is it says, quit trying. Just give up. Everybody hates you. You'll never get it right. You'll always fail. You'll never be loved. You'll never be accepted. Just give up. Conviction says, here's what you did, and I'm going to give you the power to overcome. Go and make it right, and let's move on. Go and sin no more. Shame says, you're condemned. It doesn't matter what you do, you're wrong. So when you hear those voices in your head, understand that one's a bully, and don't listen to the bully. You are not condemned. Despite failures, what others believe and say, you are not condemned. And then finally today, understand how God wants you to see others. Number one, choose to see their needs before their behavior. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? By the way, a couple tips here. Your enemies will never come to you quietly with sin or a complaint or a conviction. Your enemies will either talk to other people about you, right? Or address it publicly with you to embarrass you and to shame you. That's exactly what they were doing here, but Jesus heard them. Jesus said, it's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. Go and learn what this means. And he uses their own Bible against them from Hosea 6:6. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. Basically, you're doing all these religious things, but you don't have love. I've not called the righteous, but sinners. The Pharisees were more concerned about their laws than the people. Can we love others more than our desire to be right? Can we love others more than our desire to be right? Or are you more concerned that you're right? By the way, can I tell you that you think 100% of your opinions are right? I have never had somebody come to me and go, you know, I think I'm wrong about this, but... And you can have an opinion, and you can be right, but love that person more than you love being right. Number two, choose sensitivity over your own rights. I don't have time to go into all this, but be careful, however, the exercise of your rights doesn't become a stumbling block to the weak. Now, placators will use this to say, oh, I got to please everybody. No, no. This is talking about being sensitive to people. For example, if you love wine with dinner and you invite somebody over who's in AA, don't have wine with dinner. 1 Corinthians 12:25, so there should be no division in the body, but parts should have equal concern for each other. And that's talking about weaker parts. Do you realize to God we are all special needs? You might be the smartest person in here, but to God, you're not that smart. You might have more together than anybody else. Guess what? You're still special needs. We all need to be sensitive to one another. Jason O'Neill says, we judge others by their actions and ourselves by our intentions. We need to offer grace to all because we all need a little, I would say a lot, grace. Number three, he wants us to focus on the best things. Now, people talk about this, about life, and it will change your life to be positive. But the truth is, how about we look at others this way? Instead of seeing what somebody else does wrong or what we don't like about what they do or whatever, how about we, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right. Judy, let's go to that verse, okay? Whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent, Bill and Ted. If anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Do you realize we tend to critique and criticize people more than we ever praise them and thank them? Think about how you treat other people. Pay attention. Keep a list. You want to have a good marriage? You guys are getting married this weekend. You want to have a great marriage? Apply this to each other. Congratulations, by the way. They get married Saturday. If you ever struggle, remember, my counseling's not that great, but it's free. to say amen. I used to like you, Reed Hart. Can I focus on the value of others? There's a lady named Christine Kane. If you never read anything by her, she's phenomenal.
Yes. Yes.
She was Greek, grew up, rejected in school, rejected as a child, abused. She became a Christian, still didn't learn how to receive the things we're talking about today. But one day she started figuring out who she was in Christ, began to receive that. Not only did she become confident, she started saying, okay, God, how can I free others? She actually formed something called A21 Ministries, which has helped thousands of women be freed from human trafficking all over the world. Right now it's in over 11 countries. Why? Because when you realize what God's done for you, guess what? You quit thinking of you so much. And you quit thinking of how other people treat you, and you start looking outside and go, how can I help somebody else? And some of us are trapped because of shame and guilt and betrayal and hurt, and we're so busy thinking about ourselves that we've never taken time to say, God, thank you that you love me. Now help me to pour that out on other people. And by the way, let me tell you what happens when you become a Christian like this. I had a guy sit in my office this week, and he told me something, and I said, well, dude, if you want to do that, you can do it. Bible says it's wrong. You can do whatever you want. I just want you to know, I'm going to love you the same, regardless of what you do. You can do whatever you want. It's your life, not my life. I don't mind what you do. I'm just going to tell you what's right and wrong. But you can do whatever you want. It doesn't bother me a bit. And when you realize that there's no shame on you, you don't feel like you have to keep everybody else in their place. You can say to them, here's the truth and here's what you do. But if you decide not to do it, hey, that's between you and God, not you and me. So how to understand others? Number one, ask God to remove your own rejection, shame, and blame. Ask God to help you to be sensitive to his promptings. Let me tell you something that's awesome about God. God can use this donkey to be a blessing to other people. He can use this unsmooth, nerdy, don't always get it right, don't even know how to dress, can't comb my hair right, you know. But I can be talking to somebody and the Holy Spirit can put something on my heart and I just say it to them and they go, how did you know that? When you allow the Holy Spirit to do that in your life, it's not about telling people what's right and wrong. It's about showing them God's love. And God can use you to do that. That's why you sit in here during church sometime and you're like, how did he know? Because I didn't know, but God knew. Number three, ask God to give you his eyes for others. What if we really looked at others like God did and quit trying to judge them and compare them and fix them or make ourselves better than them? What if we really saw them? Hey, God loves them. That messed up, broken person in the mirror, God loves them. And guess what? That broken, messed up person that I work with, God loves them. That person that hurt you, God loves them. Listen to others' needs, not just their words or their actions. This is especially important for children. I was a hyperactive, messed up kid. I drove a lot of people crazy. I still do. Some people I walk there because it's not far. You'll get that joke later. Drove them crazy, walked them there. Think about it. Not far. Got it? Okay. Thank you. But there were people who saw my intentions rather than my actions. I had a mom who said, you can do whatever you want to do. I think she meant that good and bad. Like, you can do whatever you want to do. But she wanted me to know I could succeed if I wanted to. Number five, don't strive to be right. There's nothing wrong with being right. Just don't make that your main goal. You hear me? As Christians, we believe we have the truth. But it's not our job to go around with the Bible and just whack people on the head with it. I'm glad I know the truth. And I'm glad the truth set me free. And the main goal is to set other people free, not to tell them I'm right, you're wrong, you're an idiot, and I'm smart. I mean, I do think that. When I'm not right with God. Number six, ask questions. That way you can find out people's feelings. When you find that you're really aggravated because somebody doesn't agree with you, start asking questions. Start saying, I wonder why they're doing that. I wonder why they act that way. I wonder why how they're feeling. Because then you make less about what they're doing and more about who they are. God wants to know them. He wants them to be in eternity with you, and he wants us to all have dinner together one day with Jesus Christ serving dinner. Amen. If you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that today. I'll be here after the service. That's the first step in receiving God's love and acceptance, is to know, God, I surrender my life to you. I can't handle it. I'm terrible at this. I surrender my life to you. I know you died for me and rose again, and I surrender my life to you. Whatever you want me to do, I'll do. Maybe you're here today, and the truth is you have conversations in your head all the time. Condemnation, shame, blame, criticism. Maybe you make a new commitment today. God, I'm going to begin reading your word. I'm going to spend time in your word. I'm going to let you begin to change how I think. And as you do that, he will not only change you, he'll change the people around you. As you bless them, as you love them, regardless of who they are or what they do. And my prayer is that we would be a church full of people who know the truth, who are set free, but that we speak the truth in love, always in love. Let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Father, thank you for this word. Lord, these are such huge truths, and this message has been exhausting for me to share today. To reveal some things that really are painful memories, Lord, it's just hard. But Lord, I know we all have those, and we need to know that other people have them too. And Father, help us to realize that everybody is hurting, everybody has a story, but also that you have set us free. So Father, we receive that freedom and we thank you for it, and we pray that you would help us to be those who could set other people free with your love and your grace and your acceptance. Father, help us to live in your freedom and the love that you've given us. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to have our time of giving now. Listen, as you give, I don't want you to think about what you're giving. I want you to think about, God, I'm giving back part of what you've given to me. Thank you for all that you've given. So as you give today, do that. If you're a visitor today, don't feel like you need to give at all. We're so glad you're here today. I'll be here after the service if you need prayer. I'll stay as long as I need to stay. I love you guys. And,